from the guts. He played the bluesiest and darkest songs with the banjo as a serious instrument. And he sounded like he was in a different world, a different age.
Give me cornbread when I'm hungry, good people. Corn whiskey when I'm dry. Pretty women are standing around me. Sweet heaven when I die.
Today, Doc Boggs' reputation grows and grows.
I started playing banjo in my 40s, and it's all about Doc Boggs. It's all double C and G minor. I only play the kind of banjo that scares sheep, like really, really primitive.
In the 20s, Doc Boggs was photographed only once, but luckily an interview exists, recorded by Mike Seeger in 1963.
I was born in 1898. Down here at West Norton. I worked in a coal mine when I was just a boy. I never got to go to school too much. I was the youngest child out of a family of 10. I heard one colored fella, Negro, and I sneaked up the door where I could hear that music. And I listened, and that fella picked that banjo. And so I just taken up playing. And then I'd never seen another one play just exactly like me. And I played for parties, bean strings, and used to, and I was working in the coal mines in 1927 when two men from New York, here these over Norton Hotel, trying out this mountain talent. They tried out about 50, 75 musicians. I took that old banjo up there and I played about a verse of country blues. So I noticed they all marked it good on the papers, and they come around with one to sign me up to go to make phonograph records. And 3 weeks from that time, I was on my way to New York.
He went down to the local clothier, Mr. Cohen, and asked him to give him a good suit so he wouldn't look like a hick.
I've never been out of this hill. I was self-conscious enough and wanted to act as near like a human being as I should, as I could, but I was afraid I'd make a lot of mistakes. And we went into New York on the train and played for every train crew, I reckon, between Ashland and New York City. So I made 4 records, 8 songs, and I figured on making some more.
He worked at this new craft of recording, making his songs fit the exact length required for a record.
I practiced an awful lot. I even timed myself, and if my song wasn't hard long enough, well, I alternate a verse to make it come out and make a 2-minute-and-40-second record. And the records helped get them crowds.
Oh, my daddy told me, and my mama told me to. Don't you go off, honey. Let the men make a fool out of you.
By the late 20s, the word folk was being used more and more. The Library of Congress Archive of American Folk Song, the first mountain folk festival. Folk was becoming an institution. But while the folklorists collected old songs, the record companies were still looking for new talent. And in 1927, they struck gold.
Single girl, she's going dressed fine. Oh, she's going dressed fine.
In one set of sessions over a hat factory in Bristol, Tennessee, Ralph Peer found the people who would take this music forward to a national audience, making it the voice of America, not just of the South.
Having the Carter family and Jimmy Rogers in the same session would be a bit like recording Joan Baez and Bob Dylan at the same time.
Married girl, married girl, you are just any kind.
The bait was the fortune made by folk's first businessman singer, Ernest Pop Stoneman.
Mr. Peer did not put an ad in the paper for people to come. He merely said, Ernest Stoneman, my star, has made $3,600 last year. When you take mountain folks and say, he made a good bit of money, you know what that is like. Man, they come lickety-split.
Single girl, single girl, she's going where she please. Oh,
The first time Ralph Peer heard Sarah Carter singing, he says, "I heard the cash registers ringing at that point."
Married girl, married girl, baby on her knees.
And he was right. I mean, there was something about that voice that just cuts through all the decades between, cuts through the surface noise of the old records. It just gets you.
Sarah and A.P. Carter sang in harmony, but their marriage was never a happy one.
This is probably my favorite display in the museum. My granddad used the nails to support the suspenders.
A.P. Carter was a loner. He'd had the shakes from birth. He sold fruit trees for a living. There was never enough money. But his wife and sister-in-law could sing and play.
My grandmother could not believe that anyone would pay them to sing, which is something they'd always done. Maybe I'll actually ask, did she need to take her guitar? And he said, "Well, we're going to make a record. You probably need to take it."
My heart is sad and I'm in sorrow for the only one I love. When shall I see him?
The very first song that they did was "Bury Me Beneath the Weeping Willow."
Oh, bury me under the weeping willow, yes, under the weeping willow tree.
They were just happy that they had gotten paid the money to do the actual recording session and did not think too much about a record being made from it. But Mr. McClister, who ran a store in Bristol, called them and told them he had a record with their name on it, and they went and picked one up.
And so did thousands of others. Soon they were selling all over the South. Ralph Peer always wanted new songs to copyright, so A.P. Carter became a kind of folklorist himself, scouring the countryside for songs.
My granddad would spend weeks before a session going out and looking for material. He would go great distances into the mountains and a lot of times would lose track of time.
He often went with a black guitarist, Leslie Riddle. AP would write down the words, Leslie Riddle would remember or adapt the tunes.
A white man and a black man in this area traveling together collecting songs was probably a bit of a novelty. Not many people did that.
Lord, I told thee, undertaker, undertaker, please drive.
The Carters sang of getting your reward in heaven, offering consolation to country people whose world was falling apart. But their own family was falling apart. Sarah had an affair with AP's cousin and moved away. Ralph Peer encouraged them to keep it quiet.
We knew that we were not to talk about it because it hurt my granddad until the day he died. He never stopped loving my grandmother.
Can the circle be unbroken by and by, Lord, by and by? There's a bitter home awaiting in the sky, Lord, in the sky.
You can tell that it's a mountain voice. There's a quality to their voice that lets you know where they're from.
The stoical, austere Carter family, deeply rooted in a place, provide one image for the future of folk music.
I suppose you'll want your coffee then.
I sure will.
But in those same sessions, Peer also found the archetypal guitar-playing drifter, Jimmy Rogers, from Mississippi.
I'll fix your coffee.
Oh, a song? Sure, I'll give her that old guitar out of there.
He started off working the railways, but TB made him quit that job for music.
There was something magic about his voice and his songs, and he had rather immediate success. He outsold, for instance, Caruso. He did a lot of songs that were based on the blues. He called them blues.
Blues and hillbilly music would merge in this one man and become country.
All around the water tanks, waiting for a train, 1,000 miles away from home, sleeping in the rain.
Jimmy Rogers is considered to be the father of country music, the first important country music artist. But he was an artist that recorded before there was such a